Good morning, everyone. It's great to have you with us this morning, and to those joining us on YouTube, you're welcome as well. The word wings that the band were singing about in their first piece, it occurs 62 times in the Bible, the word wings. The vast majority of those references are found in the Old Testament, and a great number of them, of course, relate to angelic beings and other bizarre symbolic figures. But there are about a dozen references in the Bible where wings are used to describe a characteristic of God. Here's just three examples. How priceless is your unfailing love, O God. People take refuge in the shadow of your wings. Psalm 36. Have mercy on me, my God, have mercy on me, for in you I take refuge. I take refuge in the shadow of your wings. Psalm 57. For you have been my refuge, a strong tower against the foe. I long to dwell in your tent forever and take refuge in the shelter of your wings. Psalm 61. Both pieces that the band were singing just before we started the service reflect on this theme of God as our protector and God as our provider. We all face challenges, difficulties that we have to manage, and trouble is never very far away from our door. And all of that leaves us vulnerable, all too aware of how fragile life is, how ill-prepared we are to navigate all of this by ourselves. In the shadow of God's wings, we can take refuge. And in God's plan, we can trust. And His light is there to guide. As we gather this morning here in person or tune in via YouTube later, we have this promise that God is closer than we think. In fact, God is here. That's our reason to worship. And in a moment, we're going to join to do just that, using a song whose title is 10,000 Reasons to rejoice in and celebrate the God under whose wings we can find peace and protection. We're also going to sing As the Deer Pants, which not only echoes the theme of protection, but allows us to praise God as a joy giver, a friend, and most of all, a king. But first, let's join together in prayer. Let's pray. God of grace and glory, to this worried world, you reveal your presence in radiant glory and in gentle whispers. On mountaintops and in shadowed valleys, in classrooms and hospital beds, in homes and churches, in the quiet of nature and on busy streets. Yours is the presence that pushes past our fear to calm us. Yours is the love that transforms our doubt with reassurance. We come to dwell in your goodness and offer you the praise you deserve. God of mercy and forgiveness, we confess that many times things keep us from trusting fully in your love. We're often distracted by our own desires and disappointments. We cling to anger and resentment. We fear for the future rather than seek signs of hope. Forgive us. Shine your love upon us so that your glory may be seen in us. And give us courage to follow Jesus wherever he leads. Your word declares God is love and that God's perfect love casts out fear. Father, you promise that those who abide in love abide in you and you abide in them. Come now by your Spirit. Fill this place with your presence and with your power and with your peace. We pray for this. In Jesus' name, amen. Just a couple of things to draw to your attention by way of announcement today. I'm going to be off on leave for a few days from Tuesday through to next Monday. So if you need the services of a minister in an emergency, then the Reverend Jimmy Warburton, who's minister in High Street in Hollywood, is providing that pastoral cover. His details have been sent out as part of the weekly email, but you can contact Edna for those details during the week. There are hard copies of the announcement sheet available should you require one. Next Sunday, the guest preacher will be Stephen McComb. Stephen, you'll remember, was with us back at the beginning of the year. He spent 6 weeks on placement here as part of his application process to be received as a candidate for ministry within the Presbyterian Church in Ireland. And it's a great delight to be able to welcome him back next Sunday and to tell you that he has been accepted as a candidate. His name was approved at the General Assembly, having made his way through all the various stages of interview, and he'll be commencing his studies in September. So Stephen will be here to lead worship and to preach next Sunday. The final thing I want to ask for is your continuing prayers for our church family. We have had 3 bereavements in a very short space of time. And so we had services of thanksgiving for Stuart Cole on Thursday, for Mary Campbell on Friday, and then tomorrow we have a service of thanksgiving for Joe Jordan, who passed away a week ago today. And so I'd ask you to remember his wife Ruby, his sister Irene, who's also a member of ours. Remember Joe's family, his son Ian and daughter Deborah, and their families as they prepare for tomorrow, but also in the coming days and weeks and months as they adjust to new circumstances. And pray for all who have been bereaved over this past little while. I want you to join me now as we come to God in our prayers for others. So will you join me, please, as we pray? Creator God, we thank you that you are closer to us than our next breath, that you know us better than we know ourselves, that your love for all of us and for all your children is deeper and higher and broader than we can ever imagine. We thank you for all your blessings to us, and that you're close to us in all our joys and in all our sorrows. We thank you for Jesus Christ, that his life of care and mercy for those in need, his preaching of forgiveness, and his death and resurrection speak to us of your love for the world and for each one of us. May your church be a place of mercy and forgiveness. May all who are distressed find in this Christian community the peace and comfort which you offer all people. We pray for all who are seeking to plant new initiatives of faith and service in the church across this island and across the globe. We pray for those faithful folks who struggle to see green shoots amid the weeds which seem to often choke the work of the church. Yet we thank you, Father, for those who supply us with all the necessities of life. Especially today, we pray for farmers and all who bring us our food. We pray for fair trading systems to ensure that those who produce our food are given a just reward for their labors. And we pray for those in our communities who struggle to feed their families, and for an economic system which is fair to them as well as to others. We pray for our doctors, for those who look after our bodies and those who tend our minds. We thank you for all who work in healthcare, especially at this time of stress on the health service. We pray for all who are ill or who have long-term ill health, for those who suffer from pain in their bodies, and those who suffer in mind and spirit. In the name of Jesus, bring them healing and a better quality of life. We pray for all victims of war and violence, for those driven from their homes because of hatred or uprooted by poverty to seek new lives elsewhere. May your people always be welcoming to those who are new among us, even if they are very different from us. May those who claim to be Christians never stoke up hatred and division in our communities. We pray for those who have been recently bereaved, for those who mourn for loved ones long gone but not forgotten, and for those who feel that they have lost something else important in their life, a sense of belonging, an opportunity denied, a road not taken. May they all know that they can never be far from your love. And we pray for our leaders in our community, in our nation, and around the world. Give them wisdom. Keep them honest. And may they care for all the people whom they are called to serve. Now hear us, Father, in this moment of silence, as in the quietness of our hearts, we take this opportunity to remember people and situations which are close to our hearts today. Faithful God, may we keep close to you as you are always close to us, looking for ways to nurture the coming of your kingdom, and always faithful to our Savior Jesus Christ, in whose spirit we bring these prayers. Amen. We're going to stand and worship again as we sing together Across the Land. Thank you. Let's just take a moment to pray together. Let's do that. Father, as we take some time now to read your word together and to think about it and examine it and explore it, we invite your Holy Spirit to come and open our minds and hearts and souls to your living word, that we might hear your voice, that we might understand what you're saying to us, and we might respond with heart, mind, soul, and strength to your word for us today. Hear our prayer. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Never tell people how to do things. Tell them what to do, and they will surprise you with their ingenuity. The story we're going to look at this morning from Mark chapter 2 is, amongst other things, a story that illustrates ingenuity. So if you've got your Mark's Gospels with you, or if not, you can pick up a pew Bible, or you can follow it on the screen. Mark tells us that a few days later, Jesus has been out and about in the region of Galilee, preaching in the towns and villages, in the synagogues, healing people, declaring the kingdom of God. He tells us a few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. They gathered in such large numbers that there was no room left, not even outside the door, and he preached the word to them. Some men came, bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. Since they could not get to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it and then lowered the mat the man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now, some teachers of the law were sitting there thinking to themselves, "Why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Immediately, Jesus knew in his spirit that this is what they were thinking in their hearts, and he said to them, "Why are you thinking these things? Which is easier, to say to this paralyzed man, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up, take up your mat and walk'? But I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." So he said to the man, "I tell you, get up, take up your mat, and go home." He got up, took his mat, and walked out in full view of them all. This amazed everyone, and they praised God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." Breaking and entering is not the best way to win friends and influence people. Vandalism is not the best first impression. And yet, whatever way you cut it, the actions of this group of people, not specified in terms of number, but this group of people who bring their friend on a mat, their actions, well, at best we would say they're highly unconventional. At worst, they're reckless and they are dangerous and destructive and illegal. So why then is a story that features vandalism and destruction of property, why is that a story we choose to share with our children? Most, if not all of us, will have first encountered this story in our childhood. And there are lessons, good lessons, that come out of it. The idea of caring for others, the idea of working together as a team and achieving more. But Mark, when he includes the story in his gospel, does so as a series of five stories. Not all of these stories are healings. Not all of these stories have dramatic acts. Not all of these stories feature seemingly wanton vandalism. But they do have a connection. But we need to look past the principal characters to see the connection. The connection between the five stories that we're going to look at over the coming weeks, those five stories, the connection is found in the crowd, in the onlookers, in those who are watching on to the events, and to the interactions. In each case, the same faces, or at least the same group, is represented. You look at verse 6, Mark chapter 2. Now, some teachers of the law were sitting there. You scan on down to verse 15, which we haven't read yet, but we'll read in a couple of weeks' time. You read there in verse 16, when the teachers of the law who were Pharisees saw him eating. Scan on down to verse 18. Some people came and asked Jesus. And then verse 23-24, the Pharisees said to him, look, why are you doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath? And then if you skip on over to the beginning of chapter 3, verse 2, some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus. And again in verse 6, then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with the Herodians how they might kill Jesus. Jesus has gained what we might describe today as celebrity status. Having taken his message on the road, more and more people have become aware of who he is, what he's doing, and what he's saying. And so Jesus attracts attention, but he also attracts criticism. These five stories illustrate the opposition that Jesus faced, the reaction that he provoked amongst those who believed that they knew God's law, they knew God's ways, and what they knew was the right way. All will become clear that Jesus' opponents were not enamored by his words or his actions, because Jesus wasn't, in their opinion, following the time-honored traditions and patterns. To their mind and in their eyes, he was a radical. He was controversial. He was dangerous. He was a renegade. He needed to be stopped. Jesus attracted attention, but he also attracted criticism. And what we need to note is that as followers of Jesus, we too will attract attention, but we will also attract criticism. We want to go and tell other people about Jesus. We want to attract their attention for that message, that good news that we believe they need to hear. But we need to be mindful that when we do that, we will also attract criticism. It happened to Jesus. It will happen to us as well. One of the features of celebrity status, as far as Jesus was concerned, was the volume of people who would gather wherever he was. And Mark tells us here, in verses 1 and 2, that Jesus has returned to Capernaum, and the people heard that he'd come home. This was considered to be his base, his go-to place when he needed to pause. So he's come home, and Mark tells us that so many gathered there, there was no room left, not even outside the door. And he preached the word to them. Now, Mark seems to be at great pains to paint this picture of a mass of people, you know, not even space outside the door. This little detail is highly significant as this story unfolds. We learn that a group, unspecified in number, arrive. Four of them are carrying their friend who's paralyzed. They're carrying him on a mat. And it becomes very clear from the way that Mark presents the story that they have one intention one purpose, and that is to get their friend to meet Jesus. But there's an obstacle, and that obstacle is other people. So cue the ingenuity. Cue the thinking outside the box. I want you to do something for me just now. Something you may have done from time to time when the sermons have got slightly boring, but you've got permission to do it this time. I want you to look at the ceiling. Look up at the ceiling. Now, it's not the most attractive feature of this building, but I want you to focus on that just for a moment. Just keep focusing on that. I want you to imagine that you can see a light dusting of dust beginning to fall from the ceiling. That little cloud of dust beginning to descend. Keep looking at the ceiling. The dust is falling. There's a soundtrack with this falling dust. It's the sound of tearing and cracking. And so that little cloud of dust is getting more intense. And as it gets more intense, there are little shoots of sunlight beginning to burst through in amongst the dust. And then that sunlight gives way to a gaping hole. There's lots of dust, lots of sunlight, but now there's a hole. Can you see it? Can you see the hole? And can you see the sweaty, exhausted-looking, nervous, but excited faces peering in through the hole? And as you look at those faces, suddenly someone is being lowered through the hole. And then amongst the dust and the sunlight, this person on a mat is being lowered, and they're descending bit by bit by bit by bit until they're right on the ground. And as the dust settles, the mat settles right at the feet of Jesus. Where are your eyes now? They're not in the ceiling. They're right at the feet of Jesus. They're looking at this person on the mat. But not for long. Because in amongst all that's happening, you're throwing glances left and right. You're looking to see how other people are reacting. Can you imagine the look on their faces? Can you imagine the shock and the surprise? Can you imagine what it was like for the people who were outside the door trying to work out what on earth was going on? Was that the roof falling in? Are we safe? What do you mean somebody's digging a hole in the roof? What's going on? But the what soon gives way to the why. And then all eyes look to Jesus. And Jesus, we're told, saw their faith and said to the man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." I want you to notice two things that Mark highlights here. The first is what Jesus sees, and then what Jesus says. Jesus saw their faith, is what we're told. As far as Mark's record goes, the man who dug the hole, the man who lowered their friend through the hole on the mat, said nothing. Matthew and Luke also record this same story, and there's no reference there to these men saying anything. Well, in many respects, they had no need to, did they? Their actions spoke more eloquently than any words. Their friend, to whom they were clearly committed, needed help. They'd heard stories about Jesus. They knew what he was doing. And now they'd heard he was back in town. And so they hot-footed it to where they were told he was staying. Getting to the house was relatively simple. Getting to Jesus, well, that was something else. One commentator makes this astute observation. If an opening to Jesus cannot be found, one must be made. What was stopping these friends getting their paralyzed friend to Jesus? It was other people. Getting to the house was simple. Getting to Jesus was something else. Maybe there's a question there for us. Do we make it easy for people to meet Jesus? Or do we get in the way? This group of friends, the mat carriers, the roof wreckers, found a way for this man to meet Jesus. They were committed. They persevered. They took risks. They stepped outside what was normal and respectable and acceptable. They made themselves vulnerable for the sake of their friend who was vulnerable. Are we prepared to be vulnerable that others might meet Jesus? Jesus saw their faith. How much faith did they have? They had faith enough to ask. Carrying their friend through the streets to the house, manhandling him up the outside stone staircase onto the flat roof, digging a hole, then lowering their friend to the feet of Jesus, this was their way of asking. It was faith asking Jesus to act. They had faith enough to ask. Have we faith enough to ask? Let's not focus on the obstacles. There are always going to be obstacles. And if we focus on the obstacles, you know what? We get no further than the obstacle. So let's not do that. Let's not focus on the failures of the past. That's been and gone. And let's not fear failure in the future. It might never come. Let's not be obsessed with the what if or the potential ways in which things might go wrong. Let's take a leaf out of the book of this group of friends. Let's focus on the one we're asking. That's what they did. They were single-minded. They wanted their friend to meet Jesus. After that, it was in Jesus' hands. They just wanted him to meet Jesus. And they had faith enough to ask. They had faith enough to ask. We have a God-given task of showing the people that we live amongst who Jesus is. Not all of them will want to meet Jesus. Some have already made up their minds. But some are still open, some are still wondering, some are still searching. Have we faith enough to ask? The room was now silent. The dust was settling. The man on the mat, the friends peering in through the hole in the roof, the people in the room, the people pressing in from the outside, all were waiting. Waiting on Jesus. And Mark tells us that Jesus saw their faith and said to the man on the mat, "Your sins are forgiven." In an instant, the atmosphere in the room changes. For a moment, the hole in the roof is forgotten. For a moment, the man on the mat is forgotten. Did Jesus just say that? Did he say, "Your sins are forgiven"? The skeptics and the critics who had come to check out this itinerant preacher, they were aghast. Now, Mark tells us that they didn't utter a word. It's probably written all over their faces, but we do know that Jesus knew in his heart and his spirit exactly what they were thinking. And so Jesus says to them, "Why are you thinking these things?" I'm not sure that the friends looking in through the hole in the roof were all that clear about what was going on either. I'm sure they were confused. You see, they wanted Jesus to give the man a new body so he can walk. Jesus gives grace so the man can live. They wanted Jesus to give their friend a new body so he could walk. But Jesus gives grace so the man can live. Max Lucado, a writer and preacher, wrote this. He said, "If our greatest need had been information, God would have sent an educator. If our greatest need had been technology, God would have sent us a scientist. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent us an economist. If our greatest need had been pleasure, God would have sent us an entertainer. But our greatest need was forgiveness. So God sent us a Savior." For the friends, obviously for the man on the mat, the greatest need as far as they were concerned, as far as they could see, was the need for the man to be healed. Now, Jesus could see that as well. But Jesus saw something else, something more. Here in this home in Capernaum, Jesus is doing immeasurably more than anyone could ever have asked or imagined. For some in the room, it was unexpected. For others, it was no doubt stunning. And for some, it was offensive. How could he say such things? Didn't everyone know that only God can forgive sins? Aware of the hostility, the skepticism and the criticism, Jesus turns once more to the man on the mat. "I tell you, get up, take up your mat, and go home." What follows these words of Jesus must have astounded, vindicated, and angered all in the one moment. Watching from the roof, the friends were vindicated. The risk had been worth it. Their friend was healed, and he was whole. Physically and spiritually. Filled with consternation, the teachers of the law, the religious figures were outraged. The crowd, well, they were overcome and amazed. We've never seen anything like this. Jesus provides the rationale, not only for his words, but for his actions. He says, which is easier to say to the paralyzed man, "Your sins are forgiven," or to say, "Get up, take up your mat and walk"? But I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. This story, while inspiring in terms of teamwork and caring for and about others, is primarily a story about Jesus, about what Jesus does, who Jesus is, and why it matters that we meet Jesus, and why it matters that we help other people to meet Jesus. Meeting Jesus is meeting the change maker. Every story we have read so far through this chapter and a bit of Mark's gospel, every story has brought change into the lives of the people who meet Jesus. Meeting Jesus is meeting the life giver. Every story that we have read so far, Jesus brings life to those whom he meets. Every story that we have read thus far, meeting Jesus is meeting God. God is revealed in Jesus, his kingdom, his power, his purpose, his plan. What if that group of friends had sat and had a chat and said, you know, Jesus is in town. He's got a reputation as a healer. We could take Fred with us, get him to meet Jesus. Yeah, but we'd have to carry him there. And, you know, that could be quite, it would take a lot to do that. What if that had been their thought? Or what if they'd managed to get to the outskirts of the house and they saw the crowd and they turned to each other and went, I don't think we can do this. There's too many people. It's not worth it. We'll never get near them. We'll just have to go home. What would have happened to the man on the mat? I'll tell you what would have happened to the man. He would have continued to exist. He would never have lived life fully, but he would continue to exist. You see, you and I can exist without meeting God. The people around us can exist without meeting God. But if we want to live fully, live as God intends, live lives that are full to overflowing, life in all its fullness as Jesus described it, if we want to live that kind of life, if we want others to live that kind of life, then we need to meet, and they need to meet Jesus. So that's our challenge, isn't it? That's our so what this morning. That's our mission. Whose mat do we need to carry that they might meet Jesus? When it comes to meeting Jesus, this story tells us that faith matters. Faith that takes a risk. These friends were willing to take a risk. Are we willing to take a risk that others might meet Jesus? Faith trusts. They trusted that when they would put their friend in front of Jesus, something would happen. They trusted Jesus. Do we trust Jesus? See, we're not commissioned by God or called by God or instructed by God to go out and make Christians, to convert people. That's not our job. That's the job of the Holy Spirit. Our job is to introduce them to Jesus, to create the opportunity for them to meet him, and then stand back and let the Spirit of God and let Jesus do his thing. It only becomes messy when we try to do Jesus' bit. We don't have to do Jesus' bit. We just do our bit. That's what these friends did, isn't that right? They did their bit. They got their friend to Jesus, and then they let Jesus do his thing. Faith takes a risk. Faith trusts. And faith, we only need enough to ask. Jesus said, if you've got faith as big as a mustard seed, don't know if you looked at a mustard seed recently, really, really, really small, you could miss it. Jesus said, if we have faith as big as a mustard seed, we can see amazing things happen. We just need faith enough to ask. Let's pray for a moment. Father, my prayer this morning is simply this, that you will give to each and every one of us faith enough to ask. Faith enough to ask you to open doors and create opportunities and allow us to have conversations and encounters so that we can introduce people to Jesus, so we can talk to people about Jesus. Father, it scares us. We don't think we're good at this. But we don't have to do your bit. We only have to do ours. So give us faith enough to ask. And reassure us that you will hold us. You will be with us. You will keep us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask the band to come and sing a piece as we reflect on what we've just been thinking about over the last few minutes. And they're going to sing this lovely piece, "He Will Hold Me Fast."
When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, He will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through. Yeah.
May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the food we need. Forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who sinned against us. And don't let us yield to temptation, but rescue us from the evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power of the Lord forever. Amen. In a moment, sing our closing praise. And there's no tea and coffee this morning, but do stay around and chat, please. We're going to sing together. These are the days of Elijah.
Be with each one, now and always.